Asia, the cradle of mankind, the location of the birth, the maturation, and the civilization of the human race. A wide and vast land, the most densely populated area of our planet. It was from here the highways connecting the West and the East were established thousands of years ago, opening up vital veins of communication which made possible dialogues. International scientific expeditions, which have been carried out by UNESCO along the Silk Road, are one of the most useful examples of international cooperation and have provided an extensive record of historical research. Among these expeditions, the desert routes took place in China. The sea route was the long sea voyage from Italy to Japan. And the steppe route traveled through the translands of Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and Kazakhstan. All these have been well-documented ventures, providing invaluable information in the study of the history, civilization, and cultural heritage of the human race. It is not by chance that the fourth International Silk Road Expedition took place in Mongolia, and that it was named Nomads Route. Mongolia is a country where the traditional nomadic civilization still exists, and historical evidence proves that the branch routes of the Silk Road passed through this vast land. The Nomads Route International Scientific Expedition, in which many international scholars and journalists took part, began in the town of Khovd, near the western border of Mongolia. This town's history dates back more than 300 years. It was a significant junction of the Silk Road in the 18th and 19th centuries, and also in the early 20th century. Khovd town was founded in 1685 when Galdan Boshocht, a prince of the Mongolian Khanate, the Dzungar kingdom, established his fortress, palace, and military settlement, initiating grain farming on the banks of the Khovd River in preparation against the Manchu aggression. In 1762, the city was moved and rebuilt on the banks of the Boyant River. In the 19th century, Khovd consisted of three districts, Sangin town, or inner city, the Yellow Monastery, or popular tranquilization temple, and the Maimachin, or business center. In its history, the town has experienced destruction and reconstruction time and time again. Sangin town, where the Manchu governor, royal personages, official and military personnel resided, was badly destroyed during the battle for the liberation of the Mongolian people between 1911 and 1912. The Yellow Monastery of Khovd was also devastated when the dung gang of Xinjiang plundered the town in 1870. Even the Maimachin town, the Chinese commercial center, was wiped out without any trace. Khovd, which was a junction of international routes between Alyastai, Dahure, Urumqi, Okhot, Beijing, and Fars, played a very important role in establishing close contact between the West and the East, and the nomads and the settled peoples. There is a saying in Mongolia that a person having many friends is as great as the steppes. The Mongols have a very old and beautiful tradition of welcoming their guests and entertaining them with generous hearts. The local people greet their guests from the five continents with 2 meters length of blue khadak, and the finest of the milk products, which symbolize solidarity and peace. The Nomads Route International Scientific Expedition will begin from Khovd and cover about 4,000 kilometers through the aimags of Gobi Altai, Zavhan, Arhangai, Oberhangai, Bulgan, and Tuv, ending in Ulan Bator, the capital of Mongolia. Everywhere, the Mongols welcomed the members of the expedition with warmth and cordiality. For those in search of Mongolian folklore and folk art, these were unforgettable days, when the expedition frequently came across the talented and gifted people of Western Mongolia, whether on the shores of the Khalakhus Lake, or by the northern Senkarin River, or even in the Khwitl Us Pass in Chandmansum. Is to become acquainted at first hand with the nomadic civilization, its traditions, its historical heritage, and the lifestyle of the nomads of the present day, and to study and evaluate these findings and make them available to the world. Mongolia is rich in cultural remains, and it is remarkable how many relics of ancient man, implements which trace the lifestyle, the artistic capability, and the culture of the ancient inhabitants of Mongolia have reached us from the past. The expedition first acquainted itself with the above-mentioned relics. The rock petroglyphs of Tashkent belong to the Bronze Age. The portrait of a man in a two-wheeled chariot drawn by four horses on a flat rock attracted much of the attention of the researchers. This is one of many drawings of chariots engraved on the rocks of the Mongol Altai and Kangai mountain ranges. Scholars and researchers claim that the wheel was invented in Mongolia in the 3rd millennium BC, and that it was a creation of the nomadic intelligence that made such a magnificent contribution to the civilization of mankind. It is quoted in one historical source that a military commander of the Han dynasty seized 2,000 to 3,000 swords and knives from the Hunu, and all of them were Hunu copper scimitars. From this it is clear that the Hunu and their ancestors worked with copper within Mongolia. The Hunus were independent tribes who first established their own state among the nomads in the 3rd and 2nd centuries BC. Hunu was a very powerful state during the time of Modun Shanyui, who destroyed the 30,000 strong army of the Han dynasty in 200 BC and besieged Gao Din, the emperor of China, for 3 weeks in the vicinity of the present Datun. The king of Han was forced to admit defeat, and in 198 BC he signed the Treaty of Friendship with the Hunu, whom he had previously dismissed as Hu, or brutal slaves. According to the treaty, the dwellers to the north of the Great Wall owed allegiance to the Shanyui of the Hunu state, and those inside the wall owed allegiance to the Han. Besides the bronze articles, many kinds of iron implements have been recovered from Hunu graves. There is plenty of evidence from these excavated settlements that the Hunus melted ore and processed iron. One of the historical peculiarities of the Bronze Age is the square grave that one comes across everywhere in Mongolia. by examining the position in which the bodies are laid out in the grave and the various possessions that are buried with them, researchers who have studied these square graves have learned a great deal about the daily life of the ancient Mongol tribes of Central Asia, and they have also been able to trace the origin of these tribes. The deer stone is a unique monumental relic of the nomads of the Bronze Age. Over 500 deer stones have been found so far, out of which some 450, that is 90%, are within Mongolian territory. It is assumed that the deer stones were erected as memorials to respected warriors in the period of patriarch. These remarkable monuments first appeared in the middle of the Bronze Age, in the central part of Mongolia, and in the early Iron Age, or in the second and first millennia BC, they spread throughout Mongolia. The dates of historical events goes even further back. Besides the bronze relics, the expedition examined the lavish monumental remnants dating back to the Neolithic Age, as well as the Paleolithic period. The petroglyphs of Chanthwan and Ishkin Tolkoi in Khovd belong to the Paleolithic period. These petroglyphs, depicting a herd of animals on the smooth, flat rocks, were generally designed in three main styles. Those in which only the outline of the figure is engraved, those in which the whole figures are carved out, and those in which only the torso is carved, and the rest of the figure is engraved in outline. The attention of the expedition was drawn to the northern Senkerin cave. The way to Senkerin cave was not easy. The river was too flooded to cross by small cars, so the travelers had to get on a truck to reach the cave. Besides the portraits of deer, wild sheep, and camels that still exist in Mongolia, the figures of marmots, bison, and ostriches, which once inhabited Mongolia but disappeared during the 4th Mesolithic era, are depicted on the wall of the northern Senkerin cave, so that some scholars have suggested that these drawings date back to a period of 40,000 years ago. It is no coincidence that the paintings in the northern Senkerin cave are similar to those of the Paleolithic period paintings found in Western Europe, called Aurignac period, in their style, color, and in the realistic portrayal of the animals. So it is probable that the living conditions and the level of intellectual life were more or less on the same footing everywhere in Asia, Europe, and Africa, in the early stage of the development of mankind. The period when human beings first appeared in Mongolian territory was estimated in the 1950s to be approximately 40,000 years ago. But in the beginning of the 1960s, the period was extended to 100 to 200,000 years. And in the 1970s, it was again extended by another 100,000 years. Even later, it was calculated that man has existed 250 to 300,000 years. However, a Mongolian-Russian joint research team carried out an excavation of the front foothills of the Uran Khaykhan in Uzitsum by an Hunga Aymag in 1986. And the findings of this exploration confirmed the fact that man has inhabited Mongolian territory anything from 500,000 to 1 million years. This discovery is a very important contribution to research into the origin of the ancestors of mankind. Who knows whether this dating is final? Mongolia is situated at the highest point of Central Asia, with an altitude of approximately 1,580 meters above sea level. The varied landscape includes forests and mountains, plateaus and deserts, a vast landscape that provides a harmonious environment for flora and fauna of many kinds. On this land, the wild camels, sheep, goats, and horses, those are the ancestors of the present-day domestic animals, are still grazing in their natural way as they were thousands of years ago. Taming and domesticating animals is a very important milestone in human progress. Ancient man, who was courageous and strong enough to do so, used his wit and power to put wild beasts to his own use. These people were the forefathers of the present nomads. The Mongols do not consider that all tamed animals are domestic ones. They have a tradition that only those which give milk and cream, wool and hair, meat and fat, skin and hide for the use of humankind are domestic. These are the five species we have mentioned before. The Mongolian animals have acclimatized to a severe continental climate and are very resistant. As a result of exceptional weather conditions, the animals have large quantities of wool of a high quality. The camel was domesticated only 5,000 years ago. Now 90% of all camels are one-humped, and 10% are two-humped Bactrian camels. As far as the number of one-humped camels is concerned, Sudan in Africa has most of these, while the most two-humped camels are to be found in Mongolia. While the one-humped camel normally gives 2 to 4 kilograms of rough, short wool per year, the two-humped Mongolian camel gives 5 to 10 kilograms of soft, long, and fine wool per year. Some species even give 16 to 18 kilograms. The Mongolian herdsman has a rich tradition of breeding livestock. It is thousands of years old. They have accumulated great experience of pasture, plants, water, salt, and sodium, and know what the needs are of each kind of animal, so that their animals have a high level of productivity, and the quality of the produce is also high. The Mongols have a fine tradition of making dairy products. The Gobi dwellers are proud of their products made from camel milk, while the hill people are praised for their yak cream and greasy dry curd. They even make alcohol from milk, Aki, which is a kind of vodka. After distillation, they mix the curd with fresh milk and separate it from whey, then dry it. The curd may be rotten with fungi from the inside. That is why in summer it is cut into slices, but in autumn it is cut thickly. The nomads have been aware from time immemorial that dairy products contain rich fat, protein, saccharose, and various kinds of minerals and vitamins. This is their daily diet, healthy and nutritious. Moving from one place to another is the traditional age-old custom of herdsmen. They have developed a special method of animal husbandry in severe weather conditions. For thousands of years, the cattle breeders of Mongolia have been moving from place to place according to the season, the pasture, water and the weather, and the needs of the particular animal they are breeding. They need luxuriant and nutritious pasture to feed the livestock in spring and fat them up in the autumn. In search of pasture, stock breeders change places 5 to 6 times or more in 1 year. Traveling distances vary from 60 to 600 kilometers. However, the cattle breeders usually have a permanent winter place and spend summer in a regular locality. In brief, the customary practices of the nomads, often thought to indicate social backwardness, are directly related to the natural environment and its effect on economics and productivity. We come across the shell-white gers everywhere in the Gobi Desert, the plains of the steppes, and also in the mountain regions of this huge country. The ger is the traditional house of the nomad, tested by time for thousands of years. It especially suits the way of life of the nomadic herdsman, because it is very easy to dismantle and reassemble. The ventilation of a ger varies according to the four seasons, so that a ger dweller feels warm in the cold winter and comfortably cool in the heat of summer. The Mongols cover their gers with pure woolen felt. There is no household that does not know how to make felt. The covering of the ger consists of the roof, the walls, and the top cover. The wooden skeleton of a ger is made of birch or pine or larch trees and shrubs. Once the needs of utility are addressed, then artistry takes over. The Mongols like to color and to ornament the tunu and the uni, the pillar and the door, and also they're very fond of carving the wood. Barbara Frey is a Swiss scholar who is carrying out a research project and has written and published a book on the Mongolian ger for Western readers. Barbara has come to Mongolia for the first time, and this is her first visit to a Mongolian family. Her study of the Mongolian ger is much appreciated by the scholars and journalists who participated in the expedition. For more than 3,000 years, the Mongolian ger has changed comparatively little and has fully met the needs of the nomads. The Mongols are proud of their extensive land with 33 gobies. In fact, the great gobies such as the Nomin, the Sharga, the Borson and the Galba, differing from one another in geographical features and flora and fauna, are to be found in a continuous line from the territory of the Ulz Aimag on the northwestern frontier of Mongolia to the Sukhbata Aimag in the southern border of the country. The international expedition passed through the northern border of the Huisin Gobi and acquainted themselves with the well-known range known as the Mongolian Great Sand. Present Gobi was the basin of great lakes in the Mesolithic period, an important period of geographical evolution. Many petrified bones of various kinds of dinosaurs that existed approximately 200 million years ago and disappeared 65 million years ago have also been found in the Gobi of Mongolia. It offers the present generation of mankind a wonderful opportunity to visualize the prehistoric features of Central Asia. A baking heat prevails in this part of the Huisin Gobi in these July days. Mongolia has a highly continental climate. Its summer is hot and short, and there is very little rainfall. The winter is cold and long. The maximum temperature in summer is 35 degrees centigrade at high altitudes and 41 degrees in the Gobi, and in winter, minus 45 degrees centigrade to minus 53 degrees centigrade in the northern part of the country. So we can say that the Mongols are very gallant and enduring people who can withstand a temperature which fluctuates within 100 degrees centigrade. With the temperature at 32 degrees centigrade, people could hardly find shelter from the heat and were perspiring in the close, windless air. But in a few seconds a storm broke out. It was too much for the cloth tents of the expedition. The weather of Mongolia has its temper. The storm was first-hand experience of how a variation in temperature can be instantaneous and changes not only during a year, but also during an hour. Moving onwards from the shore of the Dorgon Lake, the expedition arrived at the Ik Ulthum after 3 days' stopover at the Hunkhez Islam in the Gobi Altai Aymag and Ulyastai town of Zavhan Aymag, where they appraised with great interest the history and unique cultural heritage of the nomads. Besides the various traditional performances, the expedition made themselves familiar with the three manly games and with other national amusements and everyday customs. The stock breeders of the Ik Ulthum in the Zavhan Aymag attracted much attention with the speed of their racing horses. This is one of the three manly games, which have provided the Mongolian tribes with festive ceremonies since the olden days. The life of the nomadic herdsmen is unimaginable without horses. And from time immemorial, the Mongols have been able to select and test a racehorse from among other horses. And they have developed a methodology of drilling the horse and adjusting its grazing before horse racing, according to the most scientific principles. The rules of horse racing in Nadam are very strict. Horses from 2 years to fully mature may take part in the races, and the distances vary according to the age of the horses. The mature horses have to cover about 30 kilometers, while the two-year-olds have to cover only 10 kilometers. Boys and girls from 6 to 8 years take part in the racing. Whenever they approach the finish, the encouragement of the crowd becomes louder and louder, and every spectator is excited further by the cheering crowd. Wrestler. The strong wrestler. Mongolian wrestling has a tradition thousands of years old. It is a trial of vitality, strength and courage, and a test of cleverness and cunning. It is the climax of the Mongolian nadam. In local nadams, 64 to 128 wrestlers usually take part in the contest, while in the national nadam, 512 or even 1,024 wrestlers compete. Titled Invincible Titans, distinguished and well-known wrestlers such as Darin Damdin, Dibdin Monkbat, and Folugin Bayanmonk took part in the 1992 National Nadam. Darin Damdin and Dibdin Monkbat had each been national champions 5 times. While Folugin Bayanmonk had been 10 times the winner of the national competition. The festive crowd greets these invincible titans with enthusiasm and respect. Who knows whether any of the youths who take part in the wrestling competition of the Mini Nadam today on the shore of the Dorgon Lake may win the honor of competing in the national ring as a national champion and win the titan title as many as 5 or 10 times. The Mongols have produced incomparable champions who have won the national championship as many as 16 or even 26 times. Titan Vandan from Logun won the championship of the Big Nadams for the 16th time in 1923. And in 1908, Namhai, the famous Titan of the Daichin Count district in Tushit, Khanaima, became the national champion for the 26th time. There are many such splendid men in the nomad's history. Archery is another one of the three manly games. Archery has become a genuine sport as a result of the ancient archery traditions in the history of the nomadic people. The distance of the present shooting is 45 bows, or around 80 meters. The target is a small leather cylinder, woven from narrow cut leather strips. The target is displayed in two kinds of rows, dense or separated. The competitors shoot the target in turn with blunt-headed arrows and display their marksmanship. As everybody knows, the bow and arrow were a military weapon at a certain stage in our development. The ancient nomads worked at perfecting their bows and arrows in order to hit a target precisely, even at a great distance. Central Asia is one of the places where the so-called applied arrow, which was finely made and accurate at great distances, first originated. And eventually the nomads had the expertise to invent the free black bow of 15 strings that could throw an arrow of about 100 centimeters, a distance of 800 to 1,400 meters, requiring a stretch power of 75 kilograms. In 1925, when the Mongolian army held a nadam at Busokchai in the upper part of the Erchis River in Altai, on the way back after the conquest of Mongolia in Khwarezm, Khasar, the son of Esukha, hit a target at a distance of 335 fathoms, and in his memory a shining monument was erected on the spot. The nomadic Mongols highly esteemed and perpetuated the memory of the Mergen Khavach sharpshooters. The traditional games are an inseparable part of the amusements of the nomadic herdsmen. The ankle shooting is one of the popular national games. The game has its strict rules, and the organized teams compete with each other. During the shooting, the players sing an encouraging and inspiring song, in which they are joined by the archers. The expedition is very happy to have an opportunity to see how the herdsman makes the straps, appliances, utensils and harnesses that are used in riding and in carrying goods. It is a part of the substantial cultural heritage of the nomadic stock breeders. While the Mongols have been using the skin and hide of animals for thousands of years, they have accumulated a particular method of processing them efficiently. On the basis of this tradition, Mongol leather produced by modern technology has become one of the goods in great demand in various countries throughout the world. It is impossible to imagine a Mongol without both a good horse and a beautiful saddle. The make and appearance of saddle is determined by its wooden structure. Saddle is much loved by people and is popularly given the name of the land where it was made and of the artisan who made it. An interesting diversion for the members of the expedition was riding on the wooden carts pulled by oxen. Through the ages, the cart had come to us almost unchanged, keeping the original design and shape. It is also pleasant to have free time for relaxation, even for 1 or 2 hours, after tremendous demands of intensive research into everything that they have come across on this long journey of many days. Even the fishermen are not empty-handed. Cooking in the skin. The nomadic herdsmen entertain their honored guest with a lunch. Luncheon that is cooked by a unique method. All the bones of the goat which has been killed are taken out, and the flesh remains inside the skin, into which various kinds of spices are sprinkled. After this, red-hot stones are put into the bag in order to cook the flesh from the inside. The nature of hospitality among the Mongols is not a casual one. It is a highly respected code, a rhythm of life and a heritage of tradition from their ancestors. The Mongolian herdsman still observes and esteems the priceless teachings of their forefathers. To be generous in sharing your meal with your guests, be lavish in dressing yourself, and earn goodwill by having friends all round you. When the expedition stopped over for 2 days at the Ulan, they got to know many people, saw and learned many things, and finally left with great excitement for the next distant destination on the final morning. They are seen off amongst many good wishes and hopes that they would meet again in the future. It was cool on the shores of the Terhin Tatan Lake at night, and our fellow expeditionaries were probably cold and spent a comfortless night. But a few hours later, their spirits were instantly thawed out by the pleasure of being introduced to the inexhaustible beauty of the eye-catching mountains surrounding the Khovd area. The Khovd is a land of the extinct volcanoes. There are dozens of craters of volcanoes, such as the Olor Gichkin, Bosok, Oron Tokok, which erupted and extinguished themselves some million years ago. The youngest of them is the Khorok Tokok. Terhin River was blocked with fluid rocks and lava of the volcano. Thus, the Terhin Sagan Nur was created at an altitude of 2,060 meters above sea level. Now the Khorokh is a lovely landscape, abundant in mountains, water, vegetation, flowers and fruits. And it is a place where whomsoever passes by can't help stopping to contemplate the beauty. This was our usual routine of passing through the long nomad's route in the nomadic manner. In the meantime, the scholars found opportunities for scientific debate. Mr. Shamir Amin, the Egyptian scholar, delivered his report on the mutual influence of the nomadic culture and civilization and other civilizations. His opinion differs from that of some of the Mongolian scholars. Such discussion and natural disagreement always has positive results for science. Ready. The travellers have a good appetite in the open air among colourful flowers. A picnic is always tasty. Mongolia is administratively divided into 18 aimags and some cities. The route of our expedition passes through the territory of the Arhangai aimag. The Arhangai is the smallest of all the aimags, but it is four times larger than Israel, and three times larger than Salvador, and twice as big as Belgium. Tetserleg is the center of the Arhangai aimag. The foundations of the town were laid more than 400 years ago when the first temple of the Zaya monastery was built in 1586. At that time, it was a very large monastery with more than 3,000 lamas. Venerable Luvhan Perenlai, the 13th, was incarnated and enthroned in 1655 as the first Zaya Pundit of Khovd. It is a historical fact that the incarnation of Zaya Pundit was embodied seven times, from Venerable Luvsan Perenle to the Venerable Jambatsaren, during 259 years, from 1655 to 1914. The Venerable Lufsan Perenle Hutta, the first Zaya Pandit of Khovd, is one of the scholarly lamas of Mongolia and a well-educated and accomplished man. The Venerable Lufsan Perenle Hutta is the author of about 120 splendid works. He was the first person in Mongolia to make an interpretation on the ancient Indian treaties Kavyadasha, Mirror of Poetry, written by Nahajuna. His own poems provide a rich fund of sensitivity, and his theories on the art of literature are profound. The Puntsag Dajalin Temple, or the Barun Khure, is called the Old Temple, or the first temple of the Undergegin. Undergegin Zanzibar, the first Bokht, or head of religion, was not only a representative of both the state and religion, but also was a man of great talent who uplifted Mongolian national art to a world class. It is something to be grateful for that these monks are still reading without any cessation the religious rituals of the first Chokchin that was recited in the temple built by the drawing of Undakakin in the Barun Khure. Why is it something to be grateful for? Because in the 1930s and 40s, as a result of the reactionary policy against religion, hundreds of monasteries were wiped out and thousands of lamas were killed in Mongolia. 300 years ago, the alien powers, the Manchu state and Tibet, took the opportunity provided by the internal conflicts among the feudal lords of Mongolia and launched a secret policy to get Mongolia into their possession, thereby damaging the friendship between Khalkh and Urd. So Galdan Boshkot, the Urd prince, in his pursuit of Undakakin Zanzibar, his declared enemy, destroyed the Barun Khure of the Khalkh and the Erdenzu monastery. Since he couldn't capture the Undakakin, he avenged himself by pulverizing the old monastery in Khan and massacring its monks. Undakakin Zanzibar preached, "If we calm down the great fire of actual suffering that is caused by tormenting our minds with an evil deed, if we annihilate the painful urge to revenge, the wonderful quality of sympathy may flourish." This is true wisdom. It is one of the positive results of democracy and reform that the people enjoy freedom of religious belief, and monasteries and temples and other holy establishments have been renewed throughout the country. The formal recitations in the Erdenzu monastery had been suspended for more than 50 years, but recently it has been renewed. The Avtai Sain Khan of Khalkh, grandfather of Gagin Zanzibar, visited Tibet and called on the Dalai Lama and adopted the yellow sect of Buddhism, Lamaism. Avtai Sain Khan escorted the god Gomkur from Tibet to Mongolia and founded the great Erdenzu monastery in the valley of the Orkhon River in 1586. The Maidar circling ceremony is about to begin. According to Lamaist belief, there are thousands of gods of well-being, and they come to our planet occasionally to spread their religion. It is believed that the first four gods out of the thousands come to the world to spread their religion, and they gracefully usher the way of divine mercy. It is also thought that the present religion is the religion of Shakyamuni. After that, when man will be overwhelmed by suffering and his body shrunk to the size of a foot, the god Maidar will come and spread his religion of grace for the well-being of man and life. The tradition of organizing an annual religious gathering and ceremony in the monasteries for the god of well-being, Maidar, who has the capability of offering grace by his spiritual power, has been renewed recently in Mongolia. The center of Karakorinsum, Oberhangai Anamak, is situated in the neighborhood of the Erdenzu Monastery. This represents the normal features of a settlement of present-day Mongolia, in which there is a state grain farm, a flour mill, a fodder plant, an irrigation system, a university, a health center, a hotel and service establishment. But the settlement is not in the old Karakoram town. Where then is the famous Karakoram city, through which the branch of the ancient Silk Road passed? There remains only one stone tortoise as evidence that Karakoram city was there. It is said that Karakoram, the capital of the Mongolian Empire in the 13th century, was founded in 1220, but it was destroyed by the Chinese army that invaded Mongolia in 1380 or 1466. So Karakoram city gradually vanished from sight. Mr. Navan is saying, you may all imagine that you are walking in the streets of Karakoram and sightseeing throughout the city. It is the dream of Mongolian scholars and the aspiration of all Mongols that sooner or later the historical monuments of Karakoram will be renovated and the people from all over the world will be able to acquaint themselves with the capital city of the nomadic Mongols of the 13th century, where Marco Polo, the Venetian merchant, and the messengers from other continents visited. According to Mr. Dane, realization of this aspiration depends on the striving of the Mongolian people. If we could fully discover the history of the nomads, it would be clear that they had constructed many splendid cities and settlements. The expedition has arrived at the Huegrin Khabaldas, situated 20 kilometers odd to the north of the Erdenzu. This is the ruin of Ordu Balik, or Baliklik, the capital of the Huegar Khanate that flourished more than 1,000 years ago. It provides the actual evidence that, taking advantage of the critical internal strife of the country, the Huegars, who were under the domination of the Turkic Khanate, revolted against the domination. Eradicating the Khanate, they established their own statehood and built their capital on the left bank of the Orkhon River. The ruins of more than 200 settlements of the ancient nomads were discovered by the researchers only in the Mongolian territory. These included the ruins of Khovd, Terelgin Dovulgin, was named by Shan Yui, the Hunu kings, as Dragon City or Dragon Stop, and also the ruins of more than 10 cities, such as the fortress of the Shuvutin River and the fortress of the Senkerin River. All these facts negate the false belief that the nomads never had cities and settlements. There are several monuments in Mongolia, such as statues, graves, and religious establishments relating to the Turkic period. The statue stone is a widespread ancient monument, not only in Mongolia, but also in Central Asia. This interesting monument spread out extensively from the Volga to Manchuria, and most of them are to be found in Mongolia. There are a great many statue stones which the Nomads Route Expedition examined on the spot. The expedition observed that there are many similar aspects among the statue stones of the Turkic period in their shape, feature, make, decoration, and the objects they hold in their hands. Mongolian researchers suggest that the Turks only erected these stones for the noble class. There are few countries where a number of monuments relating to ancient Turkey are safely kept, as they are in Mongolia. Turkic Khanate existed between 552 and 744 AD in the territory of Mongolia. Khultegin, the well-known military commander and the political veteran of the Turkic state, passed away. A shining monument was erected at his burial site by his brother, Beli Khan, and the history of his own state was engraved with the famous Orkhon Yine script on that monument. While the Nomads Route personnel have been working in Mongolia for a month, they have been familiarizing themselves with the petroglyphs of the Paleolithic period, the history of the Hunu, the first state of the ancient nomads, and the other khanates of the ancient Mongolia. The unique cultural heritage and the variety of historical monuments. They concluded that Mongolia as a whole is a magnificent, rich museum and a perpetual and abundant treasure of the history of human civilization. The international team of the scientific expedition arrived in Ulaanbaatar on the 20th day, after covering a distance of 4,000 kilometers in the land of the Mongolian nomads. The capital city, Ulaanbaatar, previously called the capital Khuray, and was known to Westerners as Orgu. It has a history of more than 350 years, marvelous examples of the intellectual culture, and many rare and precious monuments are kept here. A young research worker, Otkan Bator, whose enthusiasm is the monuments of the national literary culture, has initiated this small exhibition. If we study the development of the Mongolian script, it will be clear that the Mongolians have invented and have been using about 10 scripts during their history. It is proved by historical evidence that the forefathers of the Mongols, particularly the Hunu, the Xianpi, and the Zhujiang, had their own alphabets. Also, the Khidans had two kinds of scripts, big and small, and printed books in the 10th century. But there are several differing opinions about the time when the Mongols used their original national letters. There are a number of scholars who have rejected the idea that the Uyghurs borrowed letters from Sogdian script, and the Mongols borrowed from the Uyghur script. There are even some scholars who have suggested that there is some basis for believing the Mongols had their own original scripts thousands of years ago. Vladimirtsov, the well-known Mongolist of Russia, has said, "It is worth noting that we can say that there is not a nation of the medieval period that has attracted the attention of the historians as much as Mongolia has, and also that there is no nomadic nation that has left a literary monument depicting clearly the realities of life, as the secret history of Mongolia does. It is an inspiring event, and a significant one for science, when, under the patronage of UNESCO, the 750th anniversary of the Mongolian secret history was observed." After the end of the expedition, an international seminar on the theme of the Central Asian nomads and